in lockdown. Don't venture away from your radio. Don't go outside. Don't get infected.
Welcome to quarantine. Quarantine Radio Theater brings you new productions of old-time radio as well as new productions of original material. So, dim the lights, sit back, and close your eyes. We are in quarantine.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for meeting me here.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
Of course, no problem.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, why are we here?
Well, everyone is so busy right now, and we needed someone to record the intro for Carmilla, so I volunteered.
Which explains you, but why are we here?
Since we're coming up on the end of the first season, I thought it'd be nice to give a special little shout-out to Brandt for all of his hard work on editing the shows. I mean, you all do a lot of work behind the scenes. I just thought we could give Brand a little extra nod right now, you know? Just to show him how much we appreciate him.
Oh, yeah, that would be
great.
Nice.
Yeah, sure. Not bad.
Cool.
Do you already have something in mind, or do you need help putting it together?
Well, Megan, and Sean, I thought you three could record the shout-out to Brand, and Kelly can record the intro for Carmilla. I'll man the board and then record and splice it all together, if that's okay.
What was that?
Dogs?
Does Brandt keep dogs here?
I don't know, but he keeps dog leashes here. See? Hanging over by the door.
Maybe the banging is coming from the dogs somewhere in the place? I don't know. Look, here's what I've typed out for the intro so far. If you all want to look over those and start recording, I'll go see if the dogs are okay.
Hello everyone out there in pandemic land. Welcome back for Quarantine Radio Theater's 8th show, Carmilla.
Before we get into the show...
Ryan? I'm gonna go check on him.
Sorry. Before we get into the show, we would just like to give a big shout-out to our fantastic guy behind the mic, Brandt.
What the... Oh my god.
That's right. Brandt does a lot of work putting our voices together in the beautiful symphony that is QRT every show. So we'd like to say from all of us, thank you.
Get away from him! Don't even think about coming this way, pizza boy. Don't make me do it. I'm going to hit you with this.
Sean?
Ryan, get out of here.
What do you think I'm trying to do? Oh my god,
Ryan, wait!
Incoming!
Is that a zombie? Sweet, merciful poops, is that the flippin' undead?
Ryan,
forget that chicken. We just let a zombie escape. Come on!
Kelly, finish the intro!
The intro? Really? Now?
We can't let our fans or Brandt down.
Megan, come on!
Megan's, wait! Megan's? Megai! Miki? Sean! Oh, shoot. Okay, fine. Where are the notes? Okay, Carmilla was originally produced in July 1940 as part of the Columbia series...
Kelly! Zombie coming your way! Catch him!
With what? Oh, fudge nuggets! Oh, no!
I'm coming, Kel!
Wait, is this still on? Now on with the show?
Thank you. Dr. Witherspoon speaking.
Is this the Reverend Witherspoon?
Yes.
This is J.S. Dodge. Do you remember me, Dr. Witherspoon? I have the big place on Maple Hill.
Oh, yes, Mr. Dodge. I remember you.
I'm in trouble, Dr. Witherspoon. Can you come over to my house at once?
Why, of course.
Thank you. It's a matter of life and death.
Dr. Witherspoon, my daughter Helen is dying.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You must help me save her life.
Only God can do that, Mr. Dodge.
We'll talk about that later. Come, she's in her bedroom here.
Who's there?
It's I, Mrs. Red, with Dr. Witherspoon.
Yes, sir.
Helen? Helen, it's Papa.
Is Carmilla with you?
Here's the minister, Helen. You remember Dr. Witherspoon?
I want Carmilla. Why don't they send Carmilla to me? What have you done to her?
Thar, dear. Lie down.
Bring her back. Bring her back.
You best get out of the room, sir. It makes her winded.
Go find Carmilla. Find her. Bring her back.
She's been like that for hours, Dr. Witherspoon.
Can't the doctors do anything?
Oh, the doctors are fools.
Mr. Dodge, who is this person your daughter keeps calling for? This, Carmilla?
I'll tell you everything in a moment, but first, Dr. Witherspoon, there's something I must check. You are an antiquarian, aren't you?
Yes, in a small way. I've written some pamphlets for the New England Historical Society and Old Puritan.
That's all I wanted to know. Sit down, please. Before I tell you my story, I want you to look at me. Do I seem normal to you, or insane?
Why, you seem rather overwrought, sir, but I would say quite sane.
Then perhaps you will believe me. My story, I think, begins 2 months ago on a warm night in June when I heard this car skid, followed by a terrific crash. I called Tony, our gardener. We ran down the drive to the state highway. A black limousine of some fancy foreign make had taken the curb too fast, sideswiped a tree, and landed half in the ditch. Glass was lying all over the road. A tall woman, dressed in black, was standing nearby and crying her eyes out.
Oh, get her out of there. Oh, my poor little Carmilla. Oh, for heaven's sake, get her out. She's dead.
What's the matter, madam? Anything we can do?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know. She's in there.
Who's in there?
My daughter Carmilla. Oh, we hit something. I can't get the back door open.
Well, maybe we can open it. Here, Tony, give a hand.
Yes, Mr. Dodge.
Okay, now pull! Why, it opens quite easily.
Oh, does it? Oh, get her out of there quickly, please.
Here she is on the floor. Okay, Tony, now take it easy.
Yes, Mr. Dodge.
All right, there. Give me that other auto blanket there.
All right.
Well, lay it on the grass over here.
Oh, is she dead?
No, just seems to have fainted. She'll be all right. Run up to the house, Tony. Get some water.
Yes, Mr. Dodge.
Oh, I was in such a hurry. I have to get to Canada by tomorrow morning.
Canada? Why, that's a good 700 miles.
I know, but I've got to get there. She's opening her eyes. Carmilla, speak to Mama. Are you all right?
Mama, where am I?
Tony came back with the water and Helen. She's always been a great one to help people and, well, she fussed over the girl, gave her water, spoke nicely to her, and it wasn't any time at all before the kid was up and on her feet again. And what does the mother do but ask me a funny question?
You wouldn't happen to know of a good hotel anywhere around this neighborhood, would you?
Hotel? Let's see,
I don't want it for myself. I want it for Carmilla.
You mean you're not taking her with you to Canada?
Oh, I don't see how I can. I've got to get there by tomorrow morning at the latest. And she's certainly no condition to travel.
Papa, why can't she stay with us?
With us?
Why, yes, Papa. We've got loads of room. Oh, please, Papa, please. Say yes. Please do.
It was an awkward moment. Ordinarily, I don't take to strangers, but these people were well-bred, rich, and, well, Helen just begged me. Ever since her mother died, I've never been able to resist anything she ever wanted. I know she'd been lonely out here in the country, so far from her friends, so I said yes.
Goodbye, Mr. Dodge. I don't know how I shall ever thank you enough.
That's all right. We'll look after her, and you think you'll be back in 3 weeks?
Oh, at the very latest. It was so kind of you.
And in case you don't come back by then, is there any way I can get in touch with you?
Oh, of course. Of course. You can reach me in Canada. Just a moment. I'll give you my card. Here it is. Mrs. C. Wood, 1211 Rue d'Ang, Quebec, Canada. I haven't got the telephone number with me, but the long-distance operator will give it to you.
Well, thanks. Thanks a lot. Well, goodbye and lots of luck.
Goodbye. Goodbye, Carmilla, darling.
Goodbye, Mama.
Car drove off like a house of fire. It seemed to scare even the dogs. We heard one howling far down the road long after it went by. I don't know why, but I felt depressed. But Helen was as happy as a lark about the whole thing. I'd never realized before how lonely she must have been all by herself until I saw how she acted with Carmilla.
Carmilla, are you up yet?
Come in.
Good morning. Or maybe I should say good afternoon. Do you know it's almost 2 o'clock?
But I still feel tired. Do you know what time Mama and I get up at home? 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh, Carmilla.
That's a real time to get up. When the light is all soft and golden, and the sky is pale blue like a painting by Moliere, and the birds are going to sleep.
Oh, but you miss everything if you get up that late.
Oh, no, you don't.
Well, come on now. I've got a million things to show you. The house, and the pool, and the garden. Look, Carmilla, isn't this an adorable summer house? My mother used to like to sit here, too. Just before she died.
Death?
Oh, let's not talk about it.
What a beautiful passion flower vine.
That's Tony's doing. He raises them. They're supposed to be very rare.
Look at this flower. It's like an exquisite insect. Look at these trickles of lavender. And its hungry green stamens curving upward, like claws.
Tony tells me that the reason they're called passion flowers is because they're a symbol of the passion of our Lord.
Silly superstition. They're really a symbol of human passion. Everything about them is wild and hungry. Do you know what my favorite flower is?
What?
The night-blooming cereus.
I've never seen it.
I have. Many times. It blooms in secret, you know. Only at night. And in utter darkness. The flowers open like moons.
Oh, how beautiful. I wish I could see one sometime.
You will. We'll go hunting for them some night together. Soon. Yes.
You didn't tell me you played. What a strange piece that is. What's it called?
Longueurs.
Longueurs. What an odd name. And yet it's somehow appropriate.
It's my favorite piece. What does it remind you of?
I don't know.
It reminds me of moonlight and a very old stone fountain. It's cool there. It's silvery. It's like the moonlight turned into silver water. I can feel it all over my body. Does the music make you feel that way too?
A little. Yes, I can almost see it. The fountain and the moonlight. When you describe it, Carmilla.
She was a funny sort of girl, this Carmilla. Romantic, temperamental, full of crazy notions. But after you were with her for a while, you couldn't help liking her. As the days went by, Carmilla became like a regular member of our little family. And then... Well, girls, looks like you'll have to give up some of your gallivanting for a while.
Oh, Papa, why?
Well, there seems to be some kind of an epidemic going around. Just been reading about it in the newspaper.
What kind of epidemic?
Nobody seems to know. 12 people have died in the next county.
Goodness. Did you hear that, Carmilla?
What is it, darling?
12 people in the next county have just died of an epidemic.
Really?
Yes. And Papa wants us to stay home from now on.
Oh, dear, that would spoil our picnic tomorrow.
You girls planning to go on a picnic tomorrow?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that wouldn't do any harm.
Oh, but this is a picnic in the churchyard.
The churchyard?
Yes. Carmilla's going to show me the funny old tombstones. We're going to go exploring, too. Carmilla says there are a whole lot of the Wood family buried in the churchyard. She wanted to check up to see if any of them were related to her.
I kept a sharp eye on them from that night on. After all, Dr. Witherspoon, Helen is all I have in the world. As for Carmilla, well, I didn't want to answer for anything to that mother of hers. One night at supper, I noticed that Helen was unusually pale. Helen, what's the matter? Aren't you feeling well? You look pale.
Oh, maybe I'm just tired. I haven't been getting very much sleep lately. Bad dreams, I guess.
I've been having bad dreams, too. I haven't slept a wink for the last 3 nights.
Have you, Carmilla? You never told me.
I didn't want to depress you. But every night, I dream that I'm awake. And suddenly, a great black cat jumps over the sill into my room.
My goodness!
That doesn't sound like much to me.
Wait a minute. The cat begins to pace. Slowly. Up and down the room. Up and down. And as it paces, it grows larger. And larger. Until it's as big as a tiger. Suddenly it jumps up on my bed.
Huh?
Helen! What's the matter?
Well, nothing. Only I've been dreaming the very same thing myself. Except that the black cat seems to turn into a wolf. A horrible, mangy wolf with long, black, pointed fangs.
Mr. Dodge, did you ever hear of such a thing?
No, it's mighty funny. I don't like the looks of it at all. Not at all. Then, Dr. Witherspoon, I consulted a physician about my daughter's health. He said she was only a little anemic. At first, I believed him. But, Dr. Witherspoon, there are things in this world about which the medical profession knows nothing. That night, after everybody had gone to bed, I was awakened by a terrible scream. It seemed to come from Helen's room. I jumped out of bed and ran down the hall. Mrs. Rudd met me at the stairs.
Oh, excuse my appearance, Mr. Dodge. Did you hear that scream?
Yes, from Miss Helen's room. Why, the door's locked.
Oh, yes, sir. Miss Helen always locks her doors at night now.
Good heavens. Helen? Helen, are you all right? Speak to me. She doesn't answer. Knock on Miss Carmilla's door. We can get in that way.
Miss Carmilla locks her doors too, sir.
What?
The two girls are always thinking they'll be murdered, sir.
Good heavens. Helen! Wait a minute. I think I hear somebody in there. Something moving. Helen, open the door quickly, dear.
Papa? Papa?
Helen, what are you doing on the floor? Good heavens, there's blood over everything.
Carmilla?
What happened to you, Helen? Why did you scream like that?
I screamed because I saw Carmilla covered with blood.
Where?
At the foot of my bed. I was having a dream. The dream about the cat again, and I woke up, and there she was, standing at the foot of my bed, all covered with blood. Didn't you see her run out of the room?
No, dear, no, no. You must have dreamed that, too. Mrs. Rudd, knock on Miss Carmilla's door, will you?
Yes, sir.
See if she's all right.
Oh, Papa!
Now, it's all right, dear. It's all right.
Miss Carmilla? Miss Carmilla, are you all right? Miss Carmilla? Oh, sir, she doesn't answer. Shall I run downstairs and get my passkey?
All right, Mrs. Rudd. And hurry.
Something's happened to Carmilla.
Now. Take it easy, dear. We'll see about Carmilla in a minute. Now. Tell me, Helen, where did all this blood come from?
I don't know. Perhaps from Carmilla. Her housecoat was soaked with it. All I know is she's in...
Please, Helen, now get a hold of yourself, my dear. Stop crying now. You say Carmilla was covered with blood?
Yes.
But look, dear, you must have been dreaming. There's no blood on the floor at all.
I tell you, I saw her, Papa.
The only blood in this room is on your pillow and your nightdress.
I've got the key, sir. But first, Tony wants to speak to you.
Tony?
Yes, sir. He says he's seen Miss Carmilla.
Good heavens.
Please, Mr. Dodge, I just seen Miss Carmilla 5-10 minutes ago walking in the garden.
In the garden?
Oh, it's true, Mr. Dodge. I swear it, Miss Carmilla, she walked like that in the garden many times late at night.
We searched for Carmilla all night long. There was no trace of her. Her bed had not been slept in. All the doors leading into her room were locked. The one window looking out of the garden was open, but the drop to the ground below was a good 60 feet. Helen was hysterical, and of course, I was just about beside myself, thinking how all this was going to sound to her mother when, suddenly, next day, just as I was calling up the local sheriff, I heard Helen's voice calling me from upstairs.
Papa, come up here. Carmilla's back.
I ran up, and sure enough, there was Carmilla, as fresh as a daisy, sitting on the edge of Helen's bed.
Oh, Mr. Dodge, what on earth is all this fuss about?
Carmilla, where have you been?
What is this? I've been in bed.
Well, no, you haven't.
Well, then something's wrong. As far as I know, I've been sound asleep in there all night long. I just woke up half an hour ago. Got up, took a shower, got dressed, came in here to say good morning to Helen.
If you think you're being funny, I may as well tell you we're in no mood for kidding. Helen has been hysterical all night. Maybe you've got a boyfriend or someone you go down to meet in the village?
A boyfriend? What an idea!
Well, why not? For what other reason would you sneak out every night?
Every night? Who says I sneak out every night?
Tony, the gardener. He says he's seen you plenty of times in the garden or walking down the drive. And not only that, he told me another thing. He's seen you sneaking back into the house in the morning, too.
It's a lie.
Papa.
I don't want to hurt you, Carmilla, but be frank with me. Otherwise, I'll have to take some kind of action.
Papa, please.
I can't have any guest of mine sneaking and prowling around the house at all hours of the night, Helen. Where did that blood on your dress come from last night? How did Carmilla get out of her room? She hasn't explained one word of this to us. If she won't, why, there's nothing more to do but wire her mother.
Oh, no!
I swear to you, Mr. Dodge, I have nothing to tell. Perhaps you were dreaming. Perhaps we were all dreaming, even Tony. I have it. I have the solution.
What is it?
I'll bet. I've been walking in my sleep.
Well, of all things, why didn't we think of that?
I haven't done it since I was a child, but it used to be a great habit with me. They used to say I had an uncanny sense of places. I could find my way through locked doors.
Oh, of course. See, Papa, how simple.
I wasn't satisfied with the whole business. Too many things just didn't seem to click. The blood on Helen's pillow, the locked doors, the 60-foot jump. I still thought Carmilla was holding out on me. There seemed only one thing to do. Hello, long distance. Will you connect me with Quebec, please? Quebec, Canada? I'd like to speak to a Mrs. C. Wood, 1211 Rue de Sange, Quebec, Canada. I don't know the number.
You are calling C. Wood, 1211 Rue de Sange, Quebec, Canada.
Yes, that's right.
New York calling Quebec, Canada.
This is Quebec.
Will you connect me with a Mrs. C. Wood, 1211 Rue de Sange, Quebec, Canada?
Just one moment, please. I beg your pardon, but there is no C. Wood listed at 1211 Rue des Anges.
Thank you.
1211 Rue des Anges is a cemetery.
When I hung up that receiver, my knees were trembling. I didn't know what to think, but I had my suspicions, plenty of them. I walked into the living room. It was late afternoon. Carmilla was playing the piano. Carmilla?
Oh.
Carmilla, when did you last hear from your mother?
Mama? Let's see. Today is Friday, Thursday, Wednesday.
Tell me the truth. You haven't heard from her at all.
I guess not.
Isn't that rather strange?
Not particularly. Mama's always been lazy about writing. She's like me.
But you were ill when she left. Wouldn't she want to know whether you had recovered?
Oh, she knows I'm all right. Helen and I sent her a telegram.
To what address?
1211 Rue de Sange, Quebec, Canada.
It hasn't been returned?
Of course not. That's Mama's permanent address.
Carmilla, you're lying to me. 1211 Rue de Sange is a cemetery.
Cemetery?
Yes. Don't pretend you know nothing about it, because you do. You and your mother are a fine team, all right. A fine team.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Thought you could fool me with that phony accident, didn't you? Thought you could worm my business secrets out of me by striking up a friendship with Helen? Well, it was a smart idea, but it didn't work out, see?
I've never heard of anything like this in my life.
Oh, you haven't, eh?
Mr. Dodge, if you think I came here after your money, you're vastly mistaken.
Then explain what you were doing prowling around the house last night.
I already told you I was walking in my sleep.
What were you doing in my daughter's room?
I wasn't. In her room. She was dreaming.
What were those bloodstains on her dress?
I know nothing of bloodstains, I tell you. I haven't the faintest idea.
I have a good mind to turn you over to the police, young lady, but I won't. For Helen's sake. Provided you leave this house at once. Mrs. Rudd?
But where shall I go? I know no one. I haven't any money.
Yes, sir.
Start packing Miss Carmilla's things at once.
Yes, sir. Oh, be careful. She's got the letter opener in her hand.
You!
Oh!
You little fool. You fouled up that time.
Papa, what happened? Who screamed like that?
Oh, Helen. Helen, darling, your father's going to send me away.
Papa, what for?
I...
Oh, Papa, how could you be so unkind? Why, Carmilla's my dearest friend.
He says I've lied to you both, that I came here to spy on you and rob you.
Papa, how could you ever think of such a thing?
I'm sorry, Helen, but this is my affair, and I have every good reason to think that Carmilla is not a real friend.
But she's done nothing. Oh, I feel so weak.
Helen?
She's fainted.
I carried Helen upstairs and called Dr. Bradley. He worked over her for 2 hours, but he couldn't even bring her back to her senses. She lay all that afternoon and evening in a deep coma. She didn't move, scarcely seemed to breathe. Downstairs in the living room, Carmilla was playing her everlasting tune. It seemed to mock us. Finally, I couldn't stand it any longer. I stood up to call Mrs. Rudd when suddenly I saw the door to Carmilla's room open very slowly. She came into Helen's room. She didn't speak to me. I heard her laugh. Carmilla?
Oh. Good evening, Mr. Dodge. Surprised to see me?
I thought you were playing the piano.
I am. You thought you could keep me out of here, didn't you? You thought Helen would let me be sent away? Do you think walls or doors or locks would keep me away from Helen? No, Mr. Dodge. She's mine. Do you hear that? Mine. See how beautifully she sleeps? She's happy now. Do you know what she's dreaming of, Mr. Dodge? I do. She's dreaming about a fountain. An old stone fountain in the moonlight.
Get out of here!
But soon, she'll dream of a cat. A great black cat who jumps over her windowsill.
Keep away from that bed! With one leap, she jumped on Helen's bed. I saw her teeth bared like fangs. Like the pointed fangs of a wolf. And then suddenly the room went dark. I could hear Helen struggling on the bed and then one agonizing scream. I groped my way toward the bed. I could see nothing of it but a great black mass. It swelled and swelled until it covered the bed like a cloud. I struck at it with my fist. But I could only hear Carmilla laughing at me. This happened last night, Dr. Witherspoon. Since then, I've been almost crazy. I know everything now. I know that my daughter has only one chance to live.
And that is?
That is if we destroy this monster who is draining her strength. This incubus. This vampire.
Vampire? Oh, vampires are mythical. They're like witches or ghosts, Mr. Dodge. You're sure that all this hasn't brought on somewhat, by your own state of mind?
My own state of mind? Good heavens, what are you insinuating, Dr. Witherspoon?
Your daughter's dreadful illness. The shock, perhaps.
Dr. Witherspoon, I have called you in to help me. I have given you all the evidence. There's no time to waste. Now tell me, from your antiquarian studies of the old Puritan families, what do you know about a family named Wood?
Wood?
I have an old portrait here my daughter picked up at a village auction just before the epidemic. It's supposed to be a picture of one of the Wood family, Mercalla Wood. Helen bought it because she thought it was the image of Carmilla. Here it is.
Oh, yes, 17th century, most attractive.
Who is this Mercalla Wood? Do you know anything about her?
Nothing very important.
What is it?
She was hanged on the village gallows as a witch.
A witch, Dr. Witherspoon. Take me to her grave.
This is the old wood plot. It hasn't been used for more than a century. Oh, dear me, the grass is so very wet. Now, let's see, Josiah Wood, Adrian Wood, Sarah Wood, Rachel Wood, beloved wife of, oh, here it is, Mercalla Wood, born 1619, died 1638. There's an epitaph here, too, but I can't read it.
It's Carmilla.
Carmilla? My dear sir, this poor creature has been dead for over 300 years.
You heard me. Didn't the books say that they can live forever as long as they have the blood of living things? Carmilla. Mercala. Carmilla! The same letters. It's the same name twisted around.
My dear Mr. Dodge, calm yourself. Here, come back to the car.
No, no. Tony, hand me that shovel.
Yes, Mr. Dodge.
Mr. Dodge, what are you going to do, sir?
I'm going to dig her out of there. I'm going to destroy her once and for all.
You have no proof that the body of this poor witch is the same as this Carmilla. You have no proof that this friend of your daughter's even is a vampire.
Don't stop, Tony. Keep on digging.
Yes, Mr. Dodge.
Are you mad, sir? Vampires don't exist. They're creatures of the imagination. This is sacrilege, Mr. Dodge. I shall have to report you to the police.
I strike the coffin, Mr. Dodge.
Thank heaven. It's getting dark. It'll be night in a few minutes. Here, give me that rope.
Where are you going, Mr. Dodge?
Into the grave. Have to haul it up out of the hole.
That rope's not strong enough, Mr. Dodge. I'm afraid she'd break.
Then I'll smash in the lid down there. Hand me the hammer. And the stake.
Right, sir.
What's that?
Huh?
Police! Quick! The hammer!
Yes, sir.
Damn the witch! Tougher than I thought. Here, come down here.
All right, Mr. Dodge.
Take a shovel and beat in that end while I smash open this one.
Yes, sir.
Stop that, in the name of the law. What do you two fellas think you're doing there?
Please, Sheriff, I can explain everything. Just... give me 1 minute more.
Get down there, men. Take that hammer and shovel away from him.
All right?
No, you... Oh, my arm!
Grave robbing, eh?
You don't know what you're doing!
You don't know what you're doing. Anyway, that's what Dr. Witherspoon says. Okay, boys, take him back to the courthouse.
This is a matter of life or death, I warn you. There's a vampire lying in that coffin. A vampire!
Listen to him, boys.
Do you want
to
know who's been causing all those deaths in the village? That body lying there, it's been killing all of you people, one by one, living on their blood.
Aw, he's cracked.
Let me open the lid. I'll prove it to you. You see that tombstone? It says Mercala Wood, died 1638. Died 1638, 300 years ago. That coffin should contain a handful of dust. I'll show you that it contains a body as fresh as any of us. A young girl with red hair.
Take him to the courthouse, boys. We ain't got no more time to waste.
For the last time, Sheriff, before it's too late! Listen. Do you hear it? That's it. She's coming to. Herself. Out of the coffin there. Stop her! Stop her before it's too late! Give me the stake! The stake!
Oh, Mr. Dodge, sir. Oi, thought you'd never come back.
How's Helen?
You must be brave, sir. She's gone. She's passed away just about a half hour ago, while Miss Carmilla was playing the piano downstairs.
Miss Carmilla?
Yes, sir. She came in about an hour ago and began to play. Miss Helen heard her from the other room. It seemed to soothe her, and she smiled at me. Carmilla's come back, she said. She's so beautiful. Tell her to come upstairs. But before I could go downstairs to get Miss Carmilla, she passed away. And now, if you'll excuse me, sir, I'll just go in and tell Miss Carmilla now. Someone ought to tell her before very long. She loves Miss Helen so much.
No.
Thank you for listening to Quarantine Radio Theater's presentation of Carmilla, featuring the vocal talents of Andrew Richards as Dodge, Emily Schneider as Carmilla, Allison Beach as Helen, Bill Burke as the Reverend Witherspoon, Sean Chevalier Kelman as Mrs. Rudd, yours truly, Brant McCants as Tony, Sherry Hawkins as Carmilla's mother, Megan Kolasicki as the operator from New York, Megan Knoll as the operator from Quebec. The sheriff was played by Kelly Hoagland, and the deputy was played by Brian Kapler. Quarantine Radio Theater is a collaborative effort uniting talented individuals from their homes. They use whatever recording means handy to try to bring you, the listener, a bit of entertainment during these uncertain times. Now, if you like what you've been hearing and want to know a little more about us and our upcoming shows, please like and follow our Facebook page. You can catch QRT shows on your favorite podcast sites as well as YouTube, and be sure to like and subscribe. So stay safe and be kind to one another. Why is the booth door open? Who let out? There they are. I'll bet the gang is running all over looking for you guys. I've been training these homing zombies for weeks. First test run seems to be a success. All right, guys, back in the cage with you. I knew if I left them in the booth, someone would let them out.